The COVID vaccine race has been nothing short of a scientific triumph. In just under 1 year, the unimaginable has happened, with not just one, but several different vaccines tested and delivered into the arms of millions in record time. But now, with explosive demand for COVID vaccines far outstripping supply, deliveries halted, and new, more lethal variants of the virus rapidly emerging, vaccine rollout has hit a massive speed bump and led to a new divide in the world between the vaccinated and the unvaccinated, from those with ventilators and those gasping for oxygen, as we see in Delhi today. So how does everyone become a winner in this sprint to the finishing line? Is the catastrophic situation unfolding in India a warning to African countries and others of what might lie ahead? How do we move from infections to injections, from vaccine desperation to vaccine solidarity? These are some of the questions myself and my co-host will be asking. There he is, David Anthony. Welcome.
Welcome, Sarah.
Is to the questions. Over to you to introduce the panel, David.
Thanks, Sarah. Yes, and I will also be fielding some questions from our audience. But first, let me introduce you to our distinguished panelists. Starting in South Africa with the Minister of Health, Dr. Zweli Mkhize. Greetings, Minister.
Good afternoon. Good evening to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We move to Oslo, Norway to welcome Dag Ulstein, the Minister of Development and Cooperation. Welcome.
Thank you so much. Really good to see all of you.
In Geneva, we have the Chief Scientist of the World Health Organization, Dr. Soumya Swaminathan. Welcome, Dr. Swaminathan.
Thank you. Great to be with the distinguished panelists.
And last, but not least at all, our own UNICEF Executive Director, Henrietta Fore, from the West Coast of the United States of America. Welcome.
Thank you, and good morning, David.
Good morning, AD4. Thank you for joining us. So to set the scene, let's take a quick look at some key data on our visualization board. 2 billion doses, that's what COVAX plans to roll out by the end of this year. So far, 87% of all COVID vaccines have gone to wealthy nations, while only 0.2% is going to African countries. Or put another way, 1 in 4 people in high-income countries have already received a COVID vaccine shot, as opposed to 1 in 500 in low-income countries. Over to you now, Sarah, for the opening question to all our panelists. To answer briefly, please, in 30 to 40 seconds.
Thanks, David, and hello again, everyone. It's great to have you all here. So I'd like to ask you all one question for a very short response. Leading scientists have said we are now firmly in the age of the pandemics. We've had SARS, we've had Ebola, and now, of course, the fear that COVID could become a permanent pandemic. Let me start. Is this your worry, Dag Ulstein? Then I'm going to move to Dr. Zweli Mkhize, to Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, and then to you, ED4. So first to you, Dag Ulstein. Is this your worry right now?
Yes, thank you so much. I think this has just showed us that we were not well enough prepared when the pandemic hit. So, and this is just being amplified when we see the extensive vaccine nationalism rolling out now. And you know, vaccine nationalism is triple stupid. It's the best recipe for prolonging the pandemic. And secondly, it threatens our own population through new mutations, and it will continue to do great damage to our own economy. Economies and jobs. And of course, it's extremely selfish also. So the case for global collaboration could not be been stronger. And as we, Minister Mkhize, and I heard from one of our colleagues at the last meeting we had in the Facilitation Council, it was said that a once in a 100-year event requires a once in a 100-year level response of cooperation and solidarity. And I think that is what it's all about now.
Thank you, Dag Ulstein. Dr. Zweli Mkhize, is it your concern now that we're in a permanent pandemic? Not sure I can hear you.
Yes,
thank you.
I can hear you. Yeah, thank you. Now, we all have the concern that we may be in an era of permanent pandemics. We do anticipate that this may not be the last. There might be several others in the next few years. And therefore, it calls for the whole global community to be prepared to respond quickly, because the next pandemic may be more devastating than the current one. But I think we have learned good lessons. There are good things and bad things that we have learned. The first good thing is that if the global community works on the basis of social solidarity, if the scientists and the business and everyone works together, we can quickly get a solution, like we've been able to get the vaccine developed within 1 year. But also we've seen that if we allow vaccine nationalism and the sense of me first and others later, then we run into a risk of in future getting a pandemic that could have been contained to actually complicate because of the other parts of the world that are left behind. So I believe that there are good lessons and bad lessons that we must take out of this.
Thank you, Dr. Mkhize. Moving to Dr. Swaminathan, is this your fear right now, a permanent pandemic?
I hope we're not in a permanent pandemic. I don't think any of us want to be in that situation. But what we are seeing now is perhaps a pandemic within a pandemic, with the rise of the new variants, which could, if we allow this virus to spread the way it is spreading now across the world, could change enough to actually look like a new virus and to become ineffective against the vaccine. So far, that has not happened. And we need to take advantage of the situation where we have the tools, we have the vaccines and the diagnostic tests, and we need to use them wisely and equitably across all populations across the world to get this virus under control. I do think, looking forward, that one of the things we need to prepare for and perhaps think of a different model is the research and development ecosystem. I mean, it's been fantastic how science has come together. Scientists have collaborated to develop these new tools in record time. However, this is something that needs to happen again and again for the future, and it needs the participation of people from around the world so that ultimately the products that are developed are also manufactured and produced in a way that is affordable and scalable so that everyone can benefit from the fruits of science.
Thank you, Dr. Swaminathan. ED4, a pandemic within a pandemic. Is this your concern too?
I think it is, and it's for a couple of reasons. One, primary healthcare, community clinics are really stretched. We have not done enough as a world to prepare the countries and the most fragile health systems for a pandemic, and we've got to be ready for the next one. The second is that we have found that there's been a very big drop off in immunizations, routine immunizations for children. This is things like measles and yellow fever and polio. And if we do not catch this, it means that you will find that there will be epidemics that will fall within the pandemics. So it's very important that we as a world realize that immunizations and vaccines work, and we've got to address vaccine hesitancy. And then lastly, I think we've all learned the lesson that it's speed and scale that we need. So to do it with the private sector, to do it together with businesses and governments and civil society, means that we as a world can help in the time of a pandemic. If we do not work together, we cannot reach all the people.
Thank you, ED4, and thank you for the reminder that it is, of course, this week is World Immunization Week, so we need to consider speed and scale, not only for COVID vaccines, but for routine immunization as well, because children are being left behind in the race for the COVID vaccine. Let me turn now to you, Dr. Swaminathan. Let's come back to you in a bit more depth for your thoughts. We're currently seeing an absolutely shocking emergency unfolding in India, a country you're from, a country you know very well as a physician, the largest weekly tally of new COVID cases anywhere in the world, including the highest number of deaths. India is in so many ways the world's pharmacy. So it's not just a crisis for India, but of course for the world. So what now for India, for COVAX? And do you see this as a warning to other countries, to African countries that have so far, by and large, had a lower case rate and a higher recovery rates, Dr. Soumya-Nathan?
Yes, Sarah, it is so painful and heartbreaking to see what's happening in India. Unfortunately, we've seen this playing out in other countries before this. We've seen cycles of this over the last 16 months, including in the high-income countries, when health systems get overwhelmed, when too many people need admission to hospital and intensive care, no health system in the world has been able to cope. So I think it's a lesson for all of us, really, to learn about what we need to do to prepare ourselves better and really have much more resilience built into health systems, and particularly focusing, as ED4 said, on that primary healthcare, which if it functions well, can deal with a lot of the problem at that level and prevent burdening of the tertiary care system that we see today, that most people are forced to turn to because there's nowhere else to go. So really bringing the focus back on primary healthcare and training the primary healthcare providers, not necessarily all doctors, but other types of providers as well, and having the links with the communities, community engagement, community empowerment, and community-led solutions. I think we've seen wonderful examples of how that's really the way that it's worked. Now, there are, of course, repercussions beyond the virus itself mutating. You know, anywhere in the world we allow the virus to spread and replicate, it's going to accumulate mutations. And so far, I think we've had a few concerning mutations which do affect the binding of the antibody to the virus and could reduce the efficacy of vaccines. But overall, the vaccines are doing a good job because they do have they induce a very broad immune response. And so we don't have a situation where they're completely not working, but we have to avoid getting there. India is also one of the major suppliers of vaccines to COVAX and to the world. And of course, again, this is where we see the whole world being one. Something that happens in one part of the world has repercussions everywhere else. And while we understand that, you know, the domestic needs and priorities are uppermost right now, as a result of that, and as a result of not having supplies from other countries and other manufacturers, COVAX is really in a difficult situation, and many countries that are depending on COVAX are going to be in a situation of having to wait for several weeks in order to receive the kind of volumes that we had anticipated vaccines. So again, we need to find a global solution. It's great to see the solidarity around India and the number of countries that have stepped up to provide support. But at the same time, I think we need to solve the vaccine supply problem into COVAX through the same kind of global collaboration mechanisms.
And do you see this now, Dr. Swaminathan, as a warning to African countries in particular, where we've seen a low rate and there aren't even enough, you know, vaccines to cover health workers, never mind the general population? As we move now from vaccines to vaccinations, we really need to be looking at that. So is this a warning now to those countries?
It's a warning and a wake-up call to everyone. We have not gotten over this pandemic, and it would be very premature for any country to think that, you know, some countries have done very well at controlling it, no doubt, but that's because of the action that they're taking. So we need to keep up that surveillance. We need to keep up the vigilance. We need to keep up all of the public health actions that we've talked about. We need to keep motivating people to maintain the distance, to wear the masks, to not gather in large gatherings, to not allow mass gatherings. Unfortunately, we need to continue all of that for quite some time to come, and any relaxation in any country could be followed by these kind of devastating consequences. We also know that cases and deaths are undercounted in many countries, especially on the African continent, just because of the lack of diagnostic testing capacity. So the real numbers are much higher than what we see in terms of actual numbers. Surveys have shown that that is true. And so the virus is there. It's very much there. It's everywhere. And so the public health actions really are important. No one should be relaxing at this point.
A number of countries, though, Dr. Swaminathan, have in fact either had doses expiring or concern about doses expiring. and indeed wanting to bin them because they've come to that point, or there's the issue of vaccine hesitancy, which we heard earlier from ED4. How do you convince countries that the benefits of the vaccines far outweigh the risks of COVID, and that they need to use the vaccines they have while they have them?
I think this is something where we have to go purely by the science and by the data. So there is no room for any opinion on this. And so when we say that the risks are small and the benefits clearly outweigh the risks, it's based on an analysis of the epidemiology. If you have 10,000 people infected with COVID, how many of those are expected to end up in hospital or to die, as opposed to 10,000 people who are vaccinated, how many of them are expected to get? And if you look at the contrast, you see that, you know, it's a minuscule number that may get a severe side effect. And of course, we need to prevent as far as possible. Health workers need to be aware of the side effects, like the AstraZeneca vaccine and the Janssen vaccines we know could be associated with extremely rare events, which are these thromboembolic events, which affect sometimes the blood vessels in the brain. And so if that happens, we need to be able to recognize and treat it. But that's happening one in 200,000, one in 500,000, sort of that sort of rate. Whereas we know that the death rate, the case fatality rate, is one in 100, two in 100, you know, in most countries. So that's where we talk about the benefit and the risks, and that needs to be communicated to people. On the expiry dates, again, this is a very technical issue because every drug has a life and an expiry date. And because these drugs, these vaccines were approved under emergency use authorization, they were given a limited expiry date as the studies were being done. And many companies have now done the studies and are asking to extend the shelf life. So WHO currently is examining the data from the companies which have asked for an extended shelf life. And it's most likely will be possible to extend shelf life beyond the 6 months that were initially granted. And that's why we encourage countries to use the vaccines they've received as soon as possible for the priority populations, of course, which we've outlined what those are: the health workers, the frontline workers, the elderly, the vulnerable, underlying risk factors, but also to hold on to the doses they have and to check with WHO or UNICEF staff in countries if they have doubts about how those vaccines could be used. Certainly, we shouldn't be wasting any supplies in any country that has them.
Right, use what you can while you've got them, indeed. What about the new variants, though, Doctor? Is that, are vaccines going to be able to keep up with these new variants that are really popping up at such a rate that it seems they can't keep up?
So it has to be vaccines plus all of the other things. And we've been repeatedly also saying that right now there are not enough vaccines. In any case, it takes time to vaccinate, you know, 5-6 billion people till we get to that population immunity or herd immunity. And that's going to take, you know, many months, potentially more than a year. So till then, we have to use the other tools that we know work, including against the variants. You know, everyone gets, you know, really alarmed that these variants are the cause of the of these outbreaks. And yes, variants that are more infectious could definitely, we can see the kind of vertical increase, you know, the exponential rise in cases that we've seen in India, even in Brazil before that. But the variants respond to the same measures. So if people distance, if you avoid mixing, you wear a mask, avoid indoor crowded settings, and get tested when you're ill, isolate contacts to be quarantined, if all of those measures are done, and they've been shown to work time and time again, even in countries that have had you know, new variants circulating. So while we ramp up vaccines, I think we have to remember that we need to get the upper hand on the variants. On the other hand, if we let the virus spread unchecked and multiply, each time the virus multiplies, it acquires a mutation. And most of these mutations mean nothing. They don't have much impact, but sometimes it could develop a mutation which could be extremely dangerous in terms of resistance to the existing vaccine. So we have to do everything to prevent that from happening.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Doctor. So let's move now from vaccine nationalism issues to vaccine solidarity. David, I think we've got some really interesting examples on Norway of how, you know, vaccine nationalism has actually given way to vaccine solidarity through the COVAX facility through Act A. So over to you, David, to speak to the minister.
Thanks, Sarah. And over to you, Minister Ulstein. Norway and South Africa have been the co-leads on the global push to facilitate equitable distribution of COVID vaccines and other tools. But despite enormous effort for a joined up multilateral approach, most deals with vaccine producers have been bilateral, leading to a global vaccine race in which there's no real finishing line and no outright winners. What has this taught us, and how can we ensure fairer distribution of COVID vaccines in the future?
Thank you, David. And you know, I think the short answer to this is that we should have had a global system and agreements in place that actually secured the first available vaccines to the critical healthcare workers and the vulnerable groups in all countries first. You know, that will be equitable access. So when we see that countries and companies making bilateral deals, that really undermines the global solutions, such as COVAX, that in the end is the only possible exit strategy that we actually got. And I think one of the things that we've been discussed here in Norway and with the government, and also in the kind of national debate that is going on, it's actually like this, that even if we were only concerned about the situation in Norway, even then, and even if we had no thought for justice and international solidarity, even then, it would be right and the smartest thing to do to invest in the global solutions. So again, this is not only about solidarity, it is also very much about self-interest. And that is why we also have to take these bold actions to be better prepared and also to detect and respond to future kind of cross-borders infectious threats also. So because if we will not kind of succeed now, we will fail not only now, but we will fail when it comes to coming together and solve future crises. That will undermine the incentives to getting together. So as you know, David, we last Friday we marked the ACT Accelerator that we had been going on for 1 year, that work. And you know, it's been much progress has been made, but there are also many lessons to be learned. And we have a long way to go before COVID-19 is under control. As we heard, 20% is the goal, the coverage through the COVAX facility. And when we look to the African continent with 1.3 billion people and knowing that it's below around 20 million people that now are vaccinated, that is just showing how uneven that is actually. But when that said, it's more than 120 countries that have received vaccines now through the COVAX facility. So we're really facing many challenges, and one of them is to close the financing gap, and that is still $19 billion. And if the world is to win this fight against the pandemic, this gap must be filled in 2021. So again, the important work for Minister Mkhize and I is really to convince the leaders of the world that no matter how much it costs to stop this pandemic, in every corner of the world, it amounts to nothing compared to the cost of not stopping it. So that is why we'll really try to engage finance ministers, private sector, and other kind of investment instruments that will be very much needed. No. So while we celebrate that more than 1 billion vaccine doses have been administered, we cannot ignore the fact that 81% of them have gone to high or upper middle-income countries. So when we know the numbers, low-income countries have received just 0.3%. And you heard right, it's 0.3%. So again, we must close the finance gap and start sharing doses through COVAX. So I think the world leaders face a moment of truth now, and that is to invest in the cause of this human and economic crisis, or to continue to spend trillions on the consequences with no end in sight. So again, this virus, as we heard from the doctor, this will continue to circulate in months, perhaps years, and with the mutation we see now, there will definitely be more of that. And ultimately, that also will create a huge threat for all of us, and it could even make the vaccines less effective. So again, the case for global collaboration couldn't be stronger, David. Over to you again.
Thank you so much, Minister Ulstein. Just asking you a little bit about your own country. Norway is one of the few countries that have been both vaccinating their own population while also allocating hundreds of thousands of vaccines through COVAX to lower income countries. How have you managed to navigate this within Norway? And why aren't we consistently seeing other high income countries and this type of solidarity elsewhere?
Thank you. You know, the idea that no one is safe until everyone is safe is so much more than a fancy slogan. It is the most tangible facts on any ground right now. And in that context, Norway has decided, and we decided that quite early, actually in November, to transfer our COVAX doses to the COVAX AMC. That was an option that we had, like 1.9 million doses. And this was actually before we started the vaccination here in our own population. But to be honest, I think that we have been quite lucky when it comes to how large the virus has spread in our own country, and that we could have had a total different discussion. I have to say that. But at the same time, I think that a lot of the people in Norway more and more understand that this is not a local outbreak. It is a global pandemic, and that we really need to treat it as a pandemic also. And that is the only possible way to come back to a more normal situation here in Norway also. And when it comes to sharing doses, I'm really glad to see that there is an increasing recognition that sharing doses is important. And we have some really good news. The last week, we had the President Macron announce that France has begun to share vaccine doses with COVAX and aiming to share, I think it's around 500,000 doses by June. And we also see some very good news from the President in United States. And earlier this month also, we heard from Prime Minister of New Zealand announced that it will be transferring more than 1.6 million doses through COVAX. So I really believe that more and more countries will follow in this also. And again, sharing doses is both the right thing to do and also the smartest thing to do to end this pandemic and coming back to a more normal situation in every country. So that is why I think we have a quite a good discussion, even though it's tough. But I think that is the challenge that the politicians need to be able to stand in also, because this is a once in 100-year event, and we need to stand up then.
Thank you so much, Minister. Another topic around the issue of sharing is on intellectual property rights to speed up vaccine production. What do you think we can do about intellectual property rights sharing? And what other tools do you see as the most promising to end vaccine nationalism and boost manufacturing capacity in every region?
You know, David, advancing production capacity is a key priority to accelerate access to COVID-19 tools. And I'm glad to see the interest from all stakeholders on this, from local level to our discussions in the ACT Accelerator. We really need to act now to ensure rapid production and equitable access now. But we also need to, as I said, build better systems for the future. One of the kind of issues, of course, is that the high demand is now. So when we try to see increased production facilities, we really need to to do that in a way that it's possible to reprogram and to be able to take down the risk for the investors and others also. But we need to do that. That's really for sure. So you also mentioned the TRIPS, the waiver, and I think we all agree that the proposed TRIPS waiver must be discussed further with a view to find a basis for consensus. And from the Norwegian side also, leading the TRIPS board now, that is something that is really, really important for us. And in these discussions, we have launched some principles to bring ideas about equitable access into practice when we're discussing vaccine production and IP rights, and in particular for the pharmaceutical companies. And those principles is about more transparency. We need to actually know the price and the volume to be able to coordinate the global effort in this. More transparency and more really a much more openness when it comes to the deals. And the second is about the price. It's not time for profit for the poor countries, the low and low middle income countries. So the principle about cost plus price is also really important. And the third is about strongly to urge all the pharmaceutical companies to implement all possible strategies to increase manufacturing capacity. And we really believe that technology transfer and voluntary licensing plays a key role when it comes to this also, because we really need to do everything we can to increase the production capacity, and especially when it comes to a more diversified kind of situation around where the vaccines are produced. And it's not only about vaccines. We need to see this in all the pillars of the Act Accelerator. So again, I think we've done a lot, and now there's kind of a matchmaking in progress where we try to find the bottlenecks, to try to find where the possible manufacturing capacity are, and also to really urge the companies to share technology, to be more transparent, so that we can see this very much needed increase in the production capacity.
Thanks very much, Minister Ulstein. Over to you, Sarah.
Thanks, David. Well, we certainly got through an awful lot on manufacturing and so many other issues related to ACT-A Accelerator. So let me turn now to the co-lead with the Norwegians, to South Africa's Minister of Health, Dr. Zweli Mkhize. First of all, Dr. Mkhize, let me start by noting South Africa today, 28th of April, has in fact restarted its vaccination campaign. So congratulations to you for that, on the approval of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. The South African variant, as we heard from other variants, from the chief scientist from WHO, the British variants, the Brazil variants, have really thrown a spanner in the works. But you've still managed so far to keep rates, cases quite low and recovery rates up. Are you concerned now, though, that what's happening in India might be a warning for South Africa, for the rest of the continent as well? And if so, what can be done?
Well, thank you very much for the question. Let me say we are concerned about the situation in India. You will also realize that South Africa and India have got very close historical and economic links, cultural links. And therefore, our people tend to be moving between these countries. Therefore, the risk of the spread of the variant is a reality that is being discussed by the public in South Africa. From what we have seen in India, I think there are four issues for me which have become very important, which we have learned from what we have gone through and what India is going through. Firstly, there is a need for intensification of the non-pharmaceutical interventions. We have gone through a second wave with a variant, and our biggest weapon was the fact that we're able to encourage the use of masks, insist on hand washing, sanitizers, as well as ensuring that there's a distancing and people staying in ventilated areas and so on, and limiting large crowds or people meeting together. We found that this was a very, very effective way of dealing with it. We didn't have any vaccines at that point, but we found that that wave was very devastating, driven by the new variant, which we call the 541YV2, which is really was also proven not to be not to be neutralized by any antibodies that had come from the previous variant, as well as the some of the vaccines, like in the case of the AstraZeneca. The second issue which we thought was very, very important is to rely on scientific research, in particular, the issue of genomic sequencing to always identify the driving variant for every upsurge or any wave. And this became very, very important in our case to be able to realize that there's a change that has happened. And this means that going forward, we need to be able to always continuously evaluate the impact of the vaccines that are currently available on the existing variant, and therefore use that information to actually empower the manufacturers of the vaccines to tweak their vaccines so that they are able to deal with the variant. And the third issue that we thought was important is the acceleration of vaccination. I think whatever we can do, we need to make sure that we speed up the vaccination. It's a concern for the rest of the African continent, because at this point, we're only at about 1.3% of the population vaccinated. Now, if you can have any of these variants becoming predominant, it means that there will be a huge risk if it becomes unmanageable. Now, we have relied on COVAX for the supply, but COVAX is actually, at this point, only going to supply 20% of the needs of the continent. In addition, there are only 7 countries that can finance their own vaccination program, which means, therefore, there's a huge amount of dependence that needs to be supported from a number of countries who have got no means to be able to care for themselves. And in this case, we think that the other challenges which we have seen on surveillance is the availability of diagnostic kits, which have a very important role to play in being able to monitor the conduct of the next wave. And therefore, you will find parts of the continent where there is not enough information to even realize the extent to which the dominance of that particular variant might be in that current wave. So these lessons mean for us that a few things need to be done. Firstly, we need to stop this issue of vaccine and nationalism. In this case, for example, COVAX will only give us 20% of the vaccines. But we're looking at about 750 million vaccines, which means the rest of the 40% needs to come from the resources of countries that were in any case struggling with weak systems, with poverty, with poor economic growth. All of this means, therefore, that there has to be additional support that needs to be brought to these particular countries. Thankfully, we've had a program now where working with the heads of state led by President Cyril Ramaphosa, we've actually got work done with the World Bank to look for alternative financing to cover the gap of the 40% so that we can have access to these vaccines. But we've seen a serious constraint from COVAX, where the constraints from various countries, the pressure from various countries makes it difficult for COVAX to supply the vaccines needed by countries that they themselves cannot embark on bilateral deals. And that, for me, is the one area of challenge that we have, which therefore means also for the whole global community to have a continent of Africa that has only got one manufacturing, which is basically a portion of the value chain, which is just a fill and finish, happening in the continent. And still part of those vaccines still exported to countries that have got better facilities is a real challenge. And we need to encourage the increase of the diversification of the manufacturing. More sites must be made available in the continent so that we can manufacture in different parts of the continent to cover the needs of the continent. And more support needs to go to countries that must develop those capability for by technology transfer, for building up their technical expertise, equipment, and so on, so that they can deal with it themselves. So all of this together, for me, means that there's a lesson we need to make out of this. There's a future which needs to be taken care of a capacity of the continent.
Thank you, Dr. Mkhize. And of course, South Africa has learned so much from its own experience in HIV and AIDS and genome sequencing, surveillance, data surveillance, and a number of other stories, which of course you're building on. You mentioned the African Union, and particularly President Ramaphosa, who has gained significant praise for the collaboration and the coordination mechanism through the African Union that has really left Africa somewhat unscathed, let's say, so far at least. And you mentioned in particular the importance for boosting manufacturing. But is it as easy as that? You know, it seems to be such a simple thing. Just give over the ingredients, give other the capacity across Africa. You have some capacity in South Africa, in the Eastern Cape in particular, to be able to do that. But a lot of other countries do not on the continent, as we heard earlier, only 1%. So how can that be turned around? How do you boost that capacity on the African continent so that we don't get stuck in this permanent pandemic again?
I think that's a very, very important point. It basically means we need the collaboration of various institutions here. In the first instance, the donor communities should be able to assist in some of the countries to help to make available certain grants to build the capacity in each of those countries. I think we need a few centers for a start, and we need a few centers to deal with the portion of the manufacturing that is easy to achieve. And on a stepwise fashion, we're able then to then build on the rest of the value chain. But we also need to then look at a number of issues. The issue of technology transfer can be done with the collaboration of the current manufacturing companies coming over to open up sites and work and invest in that particular area. It's a proper business issue. It's not even a matter of charity. So that would be very, very important. And then in addition, we are involved in this discussion of a waiver of TRIPS agreement. This is to say where there are no bilateral arrangements possible, then we mustn't find that the countries are unable to even move on. But it does require a whole a conversation with the manufacturing companies, because what we have right now, the existing companies can in fact create a number of centers working together with the country governments, as well as some of the investor community financing agents. We can actually focus on that. It may not be something that is easy to achieve, but actually what it means is that we need to start somewhere. It's unimaginable that a whole continent could actually have one site, and even that site is not catering totally for the rest of the for the continent. And we've got about 4 or 5 vaccines that are being touted for the continent, but only one of them is actually partially manufactured in the continent. So that requires attention, and it needs to be understood as an act of investment, not just charity. But at the same time, we need to understand that our inability to diversify the manufacturing of these vaccines is going to make the continent to be so vulnerable that when the variants come up and everyone else is focusing on their own population, then we are going to have variants that can actually restart a pandemic within a pandemic, which Dr. Swaminathan is talking about, is a reality if we don't attend to this challenge in the continent.
Thank you, Dr. Mkhize. And of course, you can't do that without the private sector, not charity at all, but indeed an investment. Let me turn now to ED4. You've heard a tremendous amount of views on how we get out of this. How do we bridge the gap right now? But just to go back a little bit, the facility and indeed UNICEF's work got off to the starting block a couple of months ago at astonishing speed, rolling out some 40 million plus doses in no time in trying to bridge that gap, that great divide. But it now seems to have come to something of a screeching halt, let's say. How is it recovering lost ground, given these new and emerging challenges that you've seen with the staggering increase in case rates and so on?
Sarah, thank you for noticing that we've hit a speed bump and we really need some help. So we've gotten about 50 million doses out to about 120 countries, and that is good in itself, but it's not enough. We are aiming for the 3% of the most important frontline workers, the doctors and nurses, to be able to get vaccine doses and vaccinations. And as a world, that should be something that we continue to say is essential. You've heard a great deal about solidarity, but one of the issues with the vaccines, as Soumya mentioned, they came online so quickly that some countries were not yet ready. So the readiness of countries is what we need as a world to focus on, and some are doing so. So for things like vaccine hesitancy and getting the trust of people within a community, it is a very, very important readiness factor. So that's one area that we will work on. And second and most extraordinary has been what Minister Ulstein has mentioned about donation of vaccines to COVAX. It is courageous on the part of a political leader. It is important and urgent right now. And as Minister Mkhize said, it's now. We need them now, those donations. We have asked for 5% of countries that have vaccine doses if they could donate them to COVAX. And that would really help right now. We see manufacturing capacity stepping up in the second half of this year, but we need them now. So follow the example of Norway and we will be in better shape.
Indeed. Thank you, Edie, for Norway. And of course, we have also heard in the last 24 hours, you heard also Minister Dag-Ulstein mention France, for instance. We've had the US administration all starting to kind of be behind India, supporting India, and really emphasizing the importance of COVAX. So there seems to be a glimmer of solidarity emerging, but you seem also to be saying that it might be a little too little and a little too late. What can be done at this point, though?
So, Sarah, it is an extremely important time for countries to realize that there's lots that they can do. So one is the donations, and you rightly say that we are beginning to get more countries coming in with donations. The second is import and export restrictions. We need to have them lifted if we can. It is both for raw materials as well as for finished goods. So you've heard about the need for vaccines, but also for therapeutics and for diagnostics. All of these are important in attacking the pandemic. And as Soumya very eloquently spoke about, we're going to need all of these tools. So removing those import and export restrictions are important. Then the third area is the intellectual property rights. There are many ways, as Minister Ulstein mentioned, that we can talk with companies about how they can share and cooperate and partner on their intellectual property so that there will be manufacturing plants on every continent in the world. And Minister Mkhize is correct that we need more on the continent of Africa. We are also seeing that there are companies that are setting up hubs, which are scientific laboratories so that we can detect and study variants and viruses that are found in a number of places around the world. This will help us. It is also extremely important that we get more young people to move into these roles, these professions that are in medicine, that are in research, that are in healthcare. If we can do that, if we can ready the world, it will make a very big difference. So there's lots that governments can do to help. There's lots that private industry can do to help. And there's lots that all of us as individuals can do to help.
Thank you very much, Edie. I see there's several questions are coming in from the audience, and we're going to get to them in a minute, and perhaps we'll also have a chance to hear more from UNICEF on how you're able to support countries that are not able to roll out their vaccines beyond the capital cities. We'll come to that in a minute. David, the poll, we have an interesting poll that we can put to the audience. Perhaps you could just read it out. And this is really the audience participants who are going to advise the panelists. David, why don't you read through that one?
Thanks, Sarah. Okay, this is the poll on vaccine protectionism. What advice would you give the panel to prevent vaccine protectionism now and in future epidemics or pandemics? Would you A, push for a binding UN pandemics convention to oblige countries and corporations to share vaccines and other tools to address the COVID pandemic and future health shocks? Or B, incentivize global pharmaceutical companies right now to share their intellectual property rights and transfer technology and know-how during the pandemic with future benefits in mind, such as tax breaks for them? Or C, incentivize governments in areas with low healthcare and pharmaceuticals manufacturing capacity to set aside a proportion of their budgets into boosting health systems and investing in vital pharmaceutical manufacturing capacity? Or finally, D, would you invest resources in research and development to better prepare for the next pandemic, including diagnostics, therapeutics, surveillance, vaccine development, and production capacity? Please vote now. Over to you, Sarah.
Thanks. It's going to be interesting to hear if we get the source of wisdom from our participants for our panelists. I'm sure we can all learn from the answers that are going to come in. Some of the questions, however, that are coming in, as you can imagine, are quite a number of questions from Delhi, from India, where cases are doubling every 5 days. And asking when help is on the way, not just vaccines, because as we've heard through COVAX, it's also, of course, all the other tools that are necessary. We've seen some promising signs already mentioned. So let me ask first the chief scientist from WHO and then ED4 for further insight on support to India. What is happening, not just from UNICEF and from WHO, but more broadly now and in the coming days. And also, ED4, some questions about vaccinating children, if you could take that as your second question after the solidarity to India. Over to you, Dr. Swaminathan.
So India is a very large and heterogeneous country with health systems that are shared responsibility between the central government and the state governments. And so there are differences between the different state governments in their capacity and in their state of preparedness, primary health care and public health preparedness and so on. But having said that, many of the policies, of course, are centrally developed and driven. So I think right now, of course, the immediate concern is how to cope with the increasing number of cases, the increasing number of people who are needing hospitalization, medical care, including oxygen. There's been a huge global solutions being found for the oxygen crisis, including WHO that's shipping 4,000 oxygen concentrators. The issue is not the production of oxygen. There's enough production capacity in India. It's the transport of oxygen that goes in these large tankers and cryogenic tankers for liquid nitrogen from the production sites to the cities and the hospitals. So what's needed are tankers and tanks. And I think that's being addressed and hopefully will provide immediate relief. We also need to think longer term and have to set up these oxygen generation plants and large oxygen concentrators in district hospitals, in smaller towns and cities all over India. So that's a massive effort that would need to be put in place, but it will strengthen the health system for the future. Oxygen is an essential drug, and even beyond COVID, it's going to be very important to have that. We need community level triaging, diagnostic testing, scaling up. The current positivity rates is somewhere in the range of 20% and much higher in some cities, which means a large number of people going undiagnosed in the community. So there needs to be a scaling up of rapid antigen tests as well as molecular tests as much as possible. And in some cases, using clinical case definitions and radiological and clinical features to actually manage people as COVID, even if they haven't had a diagnostic test, because the urgent issue is to really take care of them. Home care needs to be encouraged wherever possible with monitoring and with support. And the rational use of medicines is very important also to avoid things like antimicrobial resistance and other side effects from using unnecessary medications. The vaccination program's been going well so far. Over 140 million people have received their first dose. Of course, it's still only 10% of the Indian population. And I think it's important to continue to try to vaccinate the priority populations first. So large proportion of healthcare workers and frontline workers have been vaccinated, but the elderly and the above 45 year age group is very important. So, and the public health measures. So three strands: take care of the sick, enhance public health measures, including localized severe movement restrictions or so-called lockdowns, but very localized, where really it's nothing else has worked, and scaling up vaccination. All three need to be done.
Thank you, Doctor. And ED4, anything more to add, particularly on how UNICEF can, not just in India or in South Asia, but more broadly, work with the immunization foundation infrastructure that UNICEF has in place for mothers and babies, and not just for adults?
Sarah, let me just add a couple of things to Soumya's good points. One is equitable access is very important. What UNICEF does is that with WHO and with our many partners in a country, we will be working with the nonprofits and the local groups who help the ministries of health to actually vaccinate the people. So the training of healthcare workers is very important, and it is something that is ongoing. And it really does help, because there are now a lot of vaccines that are coming onto the market from different sources. And it is important that the healthcare workers know how to deal with each one. There's also another problem, Sarah, which is the black market. There are some fake vaccines that are out. So the communications, whether it's on social media or from the government or from your healthcare workers, they need to talk about what is safe for people to use. And that is going to be important for all of us. We have to catch up on missing vaccinations as a world. For children, the issues are that they might be dying of a disease, not COVID-19, because they did not get a routine immunization. So to protect children, we need to get their routine vaccinations. And then there are a good number of children that are zero dose, that have never had a vaccination. So the more that we can talk about them and reach them and make it equitable across the world, that will help all of us.
Thank you, ED4. A question from a number of South Africans, various forms of this question to South African Minister of Health, Dr. Zweli Mkhize. Are you going to be able to recover now the lost ground for the various delays in South Africa's rollout, given the fact that you are rolling out again from today, Dr. Mkhize?
Thank you very much for the question. And indeed, we do believe we will be able to catch up. Firstly, we had our plan that all our health workers will be vaccinated from the 17th of February to the 17th of May. We are still within that time frame. We will be receiving the vaccine, so we'll be able to catch up with the remainder of the health workers. We will start on time on the phase two, which is focusing on the vulnerable groups and those who are in the frontline setting, which starts on the 17th of May, going up to 17th of October. So we will be able to catch up with the time. And we will also be receiving most of our vaccines at the beginning of next month. So we have actually a total of that will allow us to vaccinate more than 60% or 67% of the population already on order.
Great, thank you. That's very, very helpful milestones for those questions coming in from South Africa. Before we go to the poll, just one final question, which is quite an interesting one, from a question from an expert in France, Dr. Swaminathan, if you wouldn't mind keeping it quite tight and as untechnical as you can, because it is a fairly technical question. But what is the kind of timeline that is foreseen by which time scientific modeling will mean that we've got universal COVID vaccination coverage? At what point will that be achieved? What percentage are we talking about to get COVID under control?
We started off hoping to cover at least 25 to 30% of the entire world's population, including all the lower middle income countries, by the end of 2021. And we're still hoping to do that. If we get about 2 billion doses of vaccine into COVAX, we should be able to do that. Though we have to keep in mind what ED4 said about the capacity of countries to also scale up these large adult immunization programs, which many countries are not used to doing at all. In terms of the modeling, a lot depends again on the supply chain and how we're able to solve the issues, how many vaccines that are under development actually pass, you know, the benchmarks, because the more candidates we have, the better. And there are some really good ones coming through, like nasal vaccines and oral vaccines, which will make it so much easier for the deployment and delivery in countries. So if that happens, then there are also more affordable vaccines at $1 a dose that are being developed. So if those come on board, then we can go faster. But right now we're probably looking at, the 2023 sometime to achieve the kind of population level coverages that will provide herd immunity for the world as a whole.
Thank you very much, Doctor. And we're fast running out of time. It's been a very intense, fact-filled and knowledgeable 1 hour. We're going to end with the poll. The poll will come up on your screen, so you'll see what the audience does give as advice to our panelists. And in the meantime, we will definitely be looking at some of these issues in much greater depth, manufacturing and other issues that have come up in future Leading Minds. So watch this space for that. That's it from me, Sarah Crowe.
That's it for me, David Anthony, and the Leading Minds team. See you soon.
And have a look at the poll results. You could keep it up on the screen, please, to the producers. Thank you, and over and out from us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.